Hey guys, it's Summer Rain from Homestead Brooklyn, and I'm here in Amsterdam in the Netherlands at the Hortus Botanicus. And one of the great things that I absolutely love about coming to Botanic Gardens is getting a look at their private collections. And it just so happens that while we were here, Hortus acquired a pelargonium collection that is literally world class. So that's what we're going to be discovering in this week's episode of Plant One On Me, Field Trip Edition. I'm here with Reinout and Lutsch, and we are standing in a recently acquired collection, which can you tell me a little bit more about how you got the pelargonium collections that you brought in?
Well, we got this collection last year. It was originally collected in the 70s by a pelargonium breeder together with researchers from the Stellenbosch University in South Africa, with botanists. And these have been in the breeder's collection for many years. And as this company was bought by another company, this collection was sort of went from one company to the other. And eventually, one of these companies said, it's only costing us money and we'd want to get rid of the collections. But at that point, also people from the Wageningen University were doing research on this collection, and they were looking for a new owner for a garden or an institution that could take care of the plants. For me, that was a difficult question because I would love to save these plants and have this high quality, scientifically interesting collection in the garden. But at the same time, we are open for the public, and these plants were supposed to be behind the scenes. So that was an interesting process. So we're now talking with the University of Wageningen that we can cooperate on caring for this collection. Mm-hmm. So, but which is great, because it's very rare to have a collection of this value in your garden. So it's a great opportunity, but also a great challenge. Fortunately, we are not alone in this. So there's a group of enthusiasts on pelargonium, and Lutz is probably the most knowledgeable person in that group, and he is helping us and our gardening team to do the right thing with these plants. So we have Lutz on the background, and so we're really happy to have him here, and he will also be able to tell you more about the plants in detail.
That's fantastic. Well, thank you. And it's so amazing that you could also bring people in with such incredible passion, who have a passion for a specific genus of plants, and you could bring them in and work with them at the Botanic Gardens as well.
Yeah, exactly. If you want to make steps in knowledge, you really have to cooperate. You have to make sure that people come together and talk about things.
Oh, mijn naam is Lutz Veenstra en ik ben van origine leraar. Ik ben nu 12 jaar met pensioen, zeg maar. Ja, ik ben al heel lang geïnteresseerd in planten eigenlijk. Met name rotsplanten, die in de bergen groeien. Maar ongeveer 15 jaar geleden liep ik tegen pelargoniums aan. En dat had mijn interesse en dat vond ik erg leuk.
Besides the fact that these plants grow on rocks, what are certain features that you fell in love with in regards to these plants?
Pelargoniums zijn bijzondere planten. Niet alleen de bloemen zijn van allemaal verschillend. Er zijn ongeveer 300 verschillende pelargoniums. Wat leuk is aan pelargoniums is dat ze zijn aromatisch, het blad geurt. Maar de bloemen die zijn ook mooi vaak. En ja, het is een heel interessant geslacht, omdat er allemaal verschillende aspecten aan bod komen. Ze zijn succulent, dus bestand tegen droogte. Nee, dit is een heel leuk geslacht om je eigen in te verdiepen.
Interesting. So in a way you could kind of collect all.
Ik probeerde het, maar het is niet mogelijk. Sommige pelargoniums zijn heel zeldzaam. Daar kan je niet aankomen. En een paar van die pelargoniums staan hier.
That's a really good segue. Maybe you could take us through some of those rare varieties and maybe show us some of your favorites as well.
Deze pelargonium, dit is pelargonium trifidum. En die is bijzonder omdat die
like licorice.
De blad is erg aromatisch.
Like anise or licorice, yeah. A little bit.
Yes. Sommige mensen vinden dit vies. Zo, hij kan heel sterk ruiken.
Oh, well, yeah, you know, anise and licorice is not for everyone.
But I hou van de lucht.
I love it.
I love it.
I love it too.
Yes.
Can you use these for anything other than aromatics? Like, are any of these edible?
Nou, dat weet ik niet. Er zijn er wel die voor medicinaal gebruik zijn. Maar deze, daarvan weet ik dat niet. Siduides, ja. Even kijken waar die staat. Is dit hem? Ja. De wortels van deze plant, die worden medicinaal gebruikt.
Mm.
Fijn gemalen. En er zijn er een reeks van toepassingen zijn ervoor, ja.
Do you have a favorite here?
Ja, Otidia. Deze komt van de de westkust van Zuid-Afrika. Het is een erg droog gebied. In this section er zijn 30 soorten in ongeveer.
So some of these ones I'm hearing that are a lot from South Africa and Namibia. Are there others that are from different parts of the world?
In Australië zijn er 8 soorten. Madagaskar, 2 soorten. Tristan da Cunha, 1 soort. En Sint Helena, ook 1 soort.
But they're all kind of in the same area then, sort of in the Australia, Madagascar, you know, in the islands in that area.
Hoofdzakelijk Zuid-Afrika. Klein beetje omhoog naar Namibië, maar verder omhoog naar Ethiopië en Saoedi-Arabië. One or two species.
Do you have some of those varieties here that you could show us, or are these primarily just South Africa and Namibia?
Yeah, I saw one from Sint Helena.
This one.
I don't know that it looks like it spreads out a little bit more.
Hij groeit op de rotsen, vlak bij de zee, zeg maar. In this section, there are 80 species.
Wow, 80.
This is the biggest section of pelargoniums. And all have a large knol.
Oh, yeah, see right here.
The tuber, yes.
Yeah. It's amazing. It looks almost like a more woody and volutinous version of a carrot. This one is interesting, too. Look at this, how it's very different, a very different leaf.
Yeah.
I mean, I know there's some begonias that kind of have a weird, some, you know, very highly dissected leaves like this. And then this one also looks like, to me, very similar to Senecio's. This one is Tetragonum.
Deze heeft erg grote bloemen en mooi. En er zijn verschillende variëteiten, ook in de bloemkleur. Een hele mooie tekening in de bloem.
And then how do you propagate these? These seem really easily propagatable. Do you just kind of cut them here and the root kind of grows from there, or what do you?
Very simple.
Yeah.
You cut it and you put it in the ground and there comes a new plant.
Another reason why you must like them. Very easy to propagate.
Yeah.
Well, it's funny because I've seen this plant in the wild in South Africa, and there it grows in a very light and dry conditions, and it's not prostrate like this one.
Yeah.
It grows up.
Oh, it grows up.
Yeah,
okay.
It grows up.
Yeah.
So if we grow this one on the greenhouse conditions, it starts to sprawl.
Ah.
But if it grows in the wild, it goes up.
Like this one, then you're trying to train it up. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. And what you're saying about Senecio is right. Senecio is a genus with a large variety, and the succulent ones that I think you are referring to are also from South Africa. And you get stem succulents, leaf succulents. You get all sorts of Senecios.
Yeah,
it's an interesting genus as well. The African name of this species is Kaneelbol of Kaneelki, and allegedly the flowers are fragrant at night.
Like cinnamon.
Like cinnamon. Yeah.
Mm. Well, the leaves and the flowers then are.
Yeah.
Are quite impressive.
Have you smelled this one at night once?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is it very fragrant?
Yeah, the whole section smells at night.
Okay.
Hmm. And then how about something like this that has, you know, just these singular sage-like leaves?
Lanceolatum, yeah.
Because whenever I think of pelargoniums, I think more of like leaves like this. Those are some of the iconic ones that I see at like garden centers or greenhouses, and of course ones that are highly fragrant. But what's always interesting about coming into collections like this is that you get a sense of the scope and the breadth and the width of a genus. And it's impressive because it expands your horizons of what the genus actually looks like. So can you tell me about this one again, one of your favorites?
Deze plant die groeit in aan de westkust van Zuid-Afrika. En hij is niet in cultuur, dus hij is heel bijzonder.
And do you know if, you said some of these are not in cultivation, so they're very rare, but are they rare in the native environments from where they are from?
Op bepaalde plaatsen komen ze wel dan wel vrij veel voor, mm-hmm. maar niet algemeen verspreid. Dat je zegt, nee. Deze plant die groeit op de in Namibië heb je bergen zeg maar, en op de top van de bergen groeit deze. Er is variëteit in de planten. Er zijn ook dwergvormen van bekend. Yeah. This one is the same species, maar deze is al een stuk kleiner.
Mm-hmm. Just has a smaller leaf.
Yes.
It has this citronella smell, but it's also there's this underlying like almost sickeningly sweet smell to it. I would just imagine that, you know, we smell it and we're like, oh, that smells good or that smells great, but really it's probably to protect the plant from insects eating it.
Nou, dat zou kunnen, maar dat weet ik niet precies. Wel, de insecten die de planten bestuiven, die hebben meestal een roltong. Dus aan de bloem, er is een nectarspoor.
Hypansium toch?
Ja, hypansium. Ja, dat heb ik goed. Deze die komt ook uit de droogste delen van het noordelijk deel van Zuid-Afrika en van Namibië. Ja, en dat is Pelargonium crassicaule. Er zijn dus zachte haren boven op het blad. Helemaal bedekt is die daarmee. Mm-hmm. Om hem tegen felle zonneschijn te beschermen. Ja.
Well, that's great.
Divisifolium. Ja, dat is ook een totaal onbekende plant.
Ja.
Die is ook niet uitgebreid in cultuur. Dus hij is heel mooi. En kijk, hij gaat het heel mooi doen. Heel fijn blad.
I really love the leaves that have like the really fine divisions. I think they're quite attractive.
Er groeien maar twee pelargoniums op Madagaskar. En dit is er één van.
That's one of them. Oh, wow.
En deze groeit hoog in de bergen. Dus hij is bijzonder. Ook die zie je niet in cultuur, bijna. I have one at home.
And then can you tell us about the Spinosa?
So, hij heeft dus spines gemaakt, yeah. Dus stekels, tegen vraat van beesten die er rondlopen.
Do any of these pelargoniums lose their leaves during a dormant season?
Most of the, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and some of them they disappear completely. Mm. So they have a tuber underground.
Mm-hmm.
They disappear in the dry season, and then they resprout again when rain comes.
Mm. Yeah. I think what's really nice about the fact that they're fragrant is that it provides an ability for people to interact with them and to draw people in to educate them on.
Yeah, and it's the same smell that is in the
candles.
The candles,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's phenomenal. That's the one that I had growing in my home, and it was a very prolific grower.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
The citronellum.
The citronellum. Okay. Yeah. Because it had the citronella smell versus the one that smells like lemon drops.
Yeah.
There's
one
I think that was up there that smelled a little bit more like candy lemon. Yeah. Well, this has really been wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing this collection with us and the viewers for Plant One On Me, because, as you said, these are not necessarily in cultivation, and it's very rare that people get a chance to see this And what's really phenomenal is just the fact that, you know, we have some other iconic geraniums and pelargoniums that we see in our garden centers and our stores, but we don't get a chance to see the breadth of all of these, particularly in one place. So thank you again for bringing us into your collection like this.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Yeah. Thanks for coming and looking at it.
Yeah.
And thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for all your insights. Okay. Hey guys, so I really hope you enjoyed that tour of the Pelargonium collection. Of course, if you're in Amsterdam, don't forget to stop at Hortus, and maybe you could even get a tour yourself of the Pelargoniums. If you like these episodes, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, and then you can follow along on my journey at homesteadbrooklyn.com and on my Instagram at homesteadbrooklyn. Bye!